So Lake Oswego's history is unique. It's one of the oldest towns in Clackamas County, and it's been reinvented twice in its 169-year history. Oswego's two iron furnaces operated about 30 years, from the 1860s to the 1890s, but all chronicle another 30-year period from 1910 to 1940. That's when the transition from company town to resort-like residential development took place. A transition, so to speak, from pig iron to nine irons. And I'll focus on one of the individuals at the fulcrum of this shift, Paul C. Murphy. But first, please allow me to set the stage. Oswego, as it was first known, began with a sawmill on what is now Oswego Creek, and it was built by donation land claimants, Albert and Miranda Durham. The Durhams named and platted the town in 1850, which is 9 years before Oregon became a state. But the plat was never filed. Platting means to divide lands into individual lots for sale. The Durhams' claim included part of the lake, so some or all of the lake has been privately owned since 1850. Durham was born in New York, and it's often repeated that Oswego was named after Oswego, New York, but it really isn't known why Durham chose that name. He was already 4 years old when the town of Oswego, New York was founded, and he never lived there. Within 5 years of establishing their claim, the Durhams started selling off their free land, so flipping real estate is nothing new. John Corse Trollinger purchased Durham's sawmill and the town site, and he filed the official plat of Oswego in 1867. Trollinger, among other endeavors, operated two steam scows, the Minnehaha and the Henrietta, on the lake. He was an inventor who held at least 7 patents, and he served as mayor of Astoria. Street names such as Ladd, Leonard, and Green honored Oregon Iron Company investors. Trollinger used the first pig cast by the new iron company as a street marker, and it's still in place at the corner of Ladd and Durham Streets. So in the tiny neighborhood bounded today by State Street, the Willamette River, George Rogers Park, and the Oswego Village Shopping Center, there are 4 of the 17 properties in Lake Oswego that are listed on the National Register of Historic Places. Those are marked with stars. And there are other historic sites. Many people assume that First Edition is Lake Oswego's oldest neighborhood, but it's actually the 3rd oldest. South Oswego, which is off of today's McVeigh Avenue, is the 2nd oldest. The discovery of iron deposits in the 1860s was the impetus for Oswego being remade into a thriving iron manufacturing town. And as I mentioned, that was the first transformation. Although there were other contributing factors, the economic panic of 1893 was a final blow that shuttered that industry. The first furnace has been listed on the National Register of Historic Places, and the second furnace was demolished in 1929. Boarding houses and company-owned workers' cottages provided housing during the, if you will, the live where you work era. The cottage to the left was demolished in 2005, and the one on the right, which was built about 1880, is on the National Register of Historic Places, and it's now the History Center and Museum run by the Lake Oswego Preservation Society. It's the oldest house in Lake Oswego that's open to the public. So after the demise of the iron industry, Oregon Iron and Steel was left with extensive land holdings that encompassed Sucker Lake, as Oswego was then known. It was not named Sucker Lake, as some people assume, for inhabitants on the shore. In fact, no one lived on the lake, basically, at this point. It was named for the suckerfish in the lake, and you can always tell a suckerfish because there's one born every minute. So the iron industry had not destroyed the land or polluted the water, so the stage was set for the second transformation of the town, and the lake began to be realized for its real estate potential. Paul C. Murphy was the alchemist behind the second transformation from the iron manufacturing town to the gold of high-end residential real estate. Alchemy was the ancient practice of trying to turn base metals, such as lead, tin, and iron, into gold. Here the alchemist is pictured at work in his laboratory, in other words, nature. Murphy had served as a treasurer of the city of Everett. His real estate career began in 1906 as one of the developers of Seattle's Laurelhurst neighborhood. The natural landscape, with the help of the Olmsted brothers, provided the blueprint for this residential district. Enhancing nature continued to be a guiding principle for all of the developments in which Murphy was involved. According to a Seattle Laurelhurst sales brochure, quote, "Here nature has lavished and endowed her most extravagant and bountiful gifts," unquote. All that was left to be done, evidently, was to build a residential district to showcase these gifts. The Seattle venture was such a success that in 1909, Murphy became involved in a Portland-based real estate venture, also named Laurelhurst. Evidently, good names were hard to come by. The land for this development had been Ladd's Hazel Fern Farm, and the Laurelhurst Company purchased it from the Ladd Estate Company, and Murphy was a founding partner as well as vice president and general manager of the Laurelhurst Company. He continued to live in Seattle, and he used the Portland Hotel as his temporary residence. About 1915, Murphy relocated his family to Portland, and that year, his house at 3475 East Burnside in Laurelhurst was under construction. The architects were Ellis Lawrence and William Holford, and the cost was $11,000. Today it's listed on the National Register of Historic Places. Murphy was active in real estate for decades, and he served as president of the Portland Realty Board in 1918 and 1919. In 1919, the Murphy home was robbed, and the plunder included jewelry, a pair of shoes, and a bottle of creme de menthe. So the Ladd and Tilton Bank had managed the Ladd family properties until the passage of the 1907 Oregon Banking Act, which prompted the separation of these assets. The Ladd Estate Company was incorporated in 1908, and William Meade Ladd, shown on the right, served as president. Stockholders were limited to the Ladd family members, and the company took over management and many of the extensive land holdings amassed by his father, William Sargent Ladd, on the left. Fine looking lads, aren't they? You have to put up with my jokes. William Sargent Ladd served as mayor of Portland twice. He was paralyzed from the waist down in his early 50s. He began development of Ladd's Addition in 1891, and he was by far the wealthiest man in the Northwest when he died in 1893 with an estate valued at $10 million, which is roughly $246 million in today's dollars. And keep in mind, he died the same year as the economic panic, although I don't think the events were related, but the value of his real estate would have been negatively affected by this depression. In a gruesome twist of fate, his grave at Riverview Cemetery was robbed, and his remains were held for ransom. In the end, the perpetrator went to prison, Ladd was cemented back in his grave, and a guard stood by until the cement hardened. So after Laurelhurst, the Ladd Estate Company became directly involved in development instead of selling their land outright. In addition to farmland, the Ladds owned the Oregon Iron and Steel Company's property in Oswego. Oregon Iron and Steel began developing Oswego in 1912, and they hired the firm of Atchison and Allen as their exclusive marketing agents. During this time, the Ladd Estate Company was developing Ladd's Addition, Westmoreland, Eastmoreland, and other areas of Portland. They weren't yet involved in Oswego. In 1923, the Ladd Estate Company took over marketing from Atchison and Allen, and that same year, Murphy joined the company. 4 years later, in 1926, Murphy and Frederick H. Strong became co-owners of the Ladd Estate Company and Oregon Iron and Steel. And by 1930, Murphy owned both companies outright. Herbert Letcher Nelson recalled the 4th of July in 1910 when he took the principals of the Oregon Iron and Steel Company on a boat ride to Lake Grove at the west end of the lake. And I quote him, "I think that on this date, the lads and the Corbetts had a picnic for a special purpose. It was to see if anything could be done with Oswego Lake, to see if it was worth anything. At that time, it had been so neglected and ignored and forgotten that they probably wondered if it was worth anything or not." So these 19th century views of Oregon Iron and Steel Company's mining and manufacturing activities are quite a contrast to this 20th century Lattice State Company map. So as I mentioned, in 1926, Murphy and his partner, Frederick H. Strong, purchased the entire holdings of the Lattice State Company and Oregon Iron and Steel for $5 million. They soon sold off everything except Oswego and Dunthorpe. This map, which is about circa 1932, shows the numerous neighborhoods that have been platted after two decades of marketing real estate. As you can see, the industrial era neighborhoods are grids, even when they're in hilly areas such as South Oswego, indicated by the lower arrow. And the Lattice State Company districts take advantage of the natural terrain and have curving roads and irregularly shaped lots, as in the Forest Hills district, indicated by the upper arrow. So this is a photo by Walter Boychuk, who worked in Oregon for half a century. He did commercial and portrait work in addition to architectural and scenic photography. This might be how Murphy envisioned the lake. But the shoreline is seen here in its natural unimproved state. Stumps still littered the shore since stands of Douglas fir trees were cut to make charcoal to fuel the furnace. And although this photo possesses a mysterious beauty, it's not the lake view that most homebuyers are seeking. So Oswego's transformation, of course, did not occur in a vacuum. National movements influenced the local aesthetics, architecture, and philosophy. These are movements about which entire books have been written, but I'll just mention them briefly. A founding belief in the City Beautiful movement that flourished at the end of the 19th and beginning of the 20th century was that urban beautification would have a positive influence on residents, improving their quality of life and helping to remedy social ills. Mud in winter and dust in summer prompted bicycle enthusiasts to lobby for improved roads prior to the advent of the automobile. The first bicycle path in Portland existed in 1896. It led towards the White House Tavern, which was about halfway between Portland and Oswego. The popularity of the White House was based on horse racing, gambling, drinking, and other comforts and distractions. So over a century has elapsed and Portland hasn't changed that much. We're still bicycling to pubs. So this advocacy of the bicyclists spread into a national movement that became known as the Good Roads Movement. In Oswego, roads were laid out to follow the contour of the land and they were edged with natural stone, all of which enhanced the beauty of the district. As a Lattice State Company brochure touts, quote, "Nothing has been marred. The winding roadways afford easy access, yet detract nothing from the native state of the district," unquote. The arts and crafts movement originated in the UK. It focused on nature as an aesthetic inspiration, as well as social reform, in reaction to the Victorian era and the soullessness of the Industrial Revolution. William Morris was one of the leaders of the English arts and crafts movement. When it was imported to the US, proponents such as Gustav Stickley and Elbert Hubbard embraced the movement's aesthetics and philosophy, but they didn't necessarily view it as a vehicle for social reform. This romanticized antidote to industrialization left its stamp on Oswego in landscapes and architectural styles, such as English cottage and Tudor, that echoed picturesque British aesthetics. Frederick Law Olmsted established the first landscape architecture business in the country. He also designed Central Park in New York. His son and his stepson inherited the business and operated under the name the Olmsted Brothers. The brothers, as I mentioned, worked on the Seattle Laurelhurst project. They also designed Terwilliger Boulevard, and they were influential in creating the National Park Service. The creation of parks across the country fostered an enthusiasm for the outdoors, and Oswego's rich recreational opportunities appealed to this sensibility. The influence of these movements, along with Murphy's singular vision, was the impetus for repurposing Oswego's natural features and former iron industry sites. The Prosser Mine was the second and largest iron mine in Oswego. It was located on what is today called Iron Mountain. The hillside was riddled with several mine tunnels, the main one extending 1,000 feet into the hillside. An 1880 issue of the Engineering and Mining Journal asserts, quote, "The company now owns over 2,000 acres of land, having purchased the celebrated Prosser ore bed containing an inexhaustible supply of iron ore," unquote. Well, those were the good old days when natural resources were inexhaustible. So part of Iron Mountain was turned into home sites for the Ladd Estate Company's Forest Hills residential district. Here is the 1928 home of Berwick Wood, the father of photographer Marion Wood Kolisch, and one of the sons of C.E.S. Wood. C.E.S. Wood was a locally renowned Renaissance man, poet, attorney, soldier, artist, and friend of Chief Joseph. Architect Ernest Fanning Tucker designed the house, and it sits atop one of the mine tunnels. Prosser's swale at the foot of Iron Mountain was what would be preserved nowadays as a wetland. As touted in this 1928 newspaper headline, it was transformed into a polo field. 1,400 sticks of dynamite were used to alter the course of the stream that crossed the site of the field. So Paul C. Murphy, as president of the Ladd Estate Company, deeded over 20 acres to the Lake Oswego Hunt in 1936, and he helped finance the arena, track, clubhouse, and stables. The grand opening event was held September 26, 1937. The arena, designed by architect John Davis Annan Sr., features magnificent bowstring arch trusses that support the massive roof to create an arena free of obstructions. It's believed to be the largest and oldest wooden arena in the West, and it's listed on the National Register of Historic Places. The Prosser Mine Road, constructed in 1877, is one of the oldest roads in Oswego. It was once used to transport ore from the mine to the furnace, first by oxen and then later in 1880 by rail. The mine road, its rails removed, became part of a system of equestrian trails constructed in 1938 that crisscrossed the face of Iron Mountain. This photo was taken in 1909. There had been a series of wooden dams at the east end of the lake that had repeatedly been washed out and rebuilt. The cement dam, built in 1921, enlarged the size of the natural lake. It's often repeated that Oswego Lake is man-made, but the Ice Age floods created it 12 to 17,000 years ago. The 1921 cement dam provided the ability to control the water level, which increased the attractiveness of lakefront lots. The Oswego Lake Country Club was built on land that had been part of William M. Ladd's iron mine farm. Ladd, who raised prize-winning livestock, was, as I mentioned, the son of William S. Ladd, a major investor in Oswego's iron industry. So just as with other Ladd developments in Portland, one of Ladd's farms was transformed into home sites and a country club golf course. Holding on to farmland until it was ripe for development was one of Ladd's strategies for accumulating wealth. It also enabled him to play the role of gentleman farmer as he waited for the right time to make the transition. His prized Jersey livestock had names such as Sultan's Birdie and Darling Glow Cruise. We don't know which beauty is pictured on this stationery, but we know the name of this one of Ladd's herd was named Owl's Victoire because this iron mine farm photo was labeled. So in 1923, Frederick H. Strong, manager of the Ladd Estate Company, announced plans for construction of a golf course located between Oswego and Lake Grove. It opened 2 years later on July 10th, 1925. The Oswego Lake Country Club was the centerpiece of the Ladd Estate Company's vision for the district. Golf was a sport that quintessentially defined leisure in the 1920s and attracted the type of residents they desired. This is a conceptual bird's eye view of the country club. And $500,000 later, which is about $6.1 million in today's dollars, this is the reality of the original course. We're lucky to have this photo because it was found behind a furnace at the country club. So country club districts near large cities were a trend that was sweeping the nation in the 1920s. Why waste precious hours of leisure time commuting to golf links? A prominent attorney quoted in a Ladd Estate Company brochure claims, quote, "One should live life every day, not just over the weekend. I feel that I live 2 hours more each day that I live in the Lake Oswego district," unquote. Street names in the housing development surrounding the Oswego Lake Country Club honor famous UK courses, Prestwick, Westward Ho, Troon, Glen Eagles. Houses backing onto the golf course exemplified the Ladd Estate Company's marketing slogan, "Live where you play." The earliest use I found of this motto is a 1926 brochure. Also in 1927, the Ladd Estate Company began to sponsor a dinnertime concert on radio station KGW called the Live Where You Play Hour. Former Seattle Mayor George Cotterill was the engineer on the project. Cotterill was a founding member of Seattle's Queen City Good Roads Club, and he had designed, surveyed, and laid out over 25 miles of bicycle paths that eventually became Seattle's boulevards. So I guess you can blame him for Seattle's traffic. Cotterill also platted Laurelhurst in Portland, and as a Washington state senator, he helped frame the amendment for women's suffrage, and his mother voted for the first time in her life at the age of 75. Henry Chandler Egan laid out the 18-hole course. After surveying the site, Egan was quoted in a 1923 Oregonian article, quote, "This Lake Oswego course is typically Oregon. The rolling meadows, the fir-clad hills, and scenic attractions make it a place for inspiration. The golfer who does not feel better after playing there will be hopeless indeed," unquote. Egan later remodeled the course at Pebble Beach, and he was the architect of many other courses as well as an accomplished amateur golfer. Three streets in Oswego are named after him: Chandler Road, Chandler Place, and Egan Way. Architect Morris H. Whitehouse designed the arts and crafts style clubhouse that opened in 1926. During this period, Whitehouse also designed the U.S. Courthouse in Portland, and he collaborated with A.E. Doyle on the Multnomah Stadium. In this photo, you can see women having lunch al fresco in front of the clubhouse. Many of the leisure activities provided for club members are pictured in this hand-tinted photo. Reality lives up to the Ladd Estate Company sales brochure that claims, quote, 5 minutes from home brings you to a splendid 18-hole golf course, riding trails that urge you on, beautiful sail-dotted Lake Oswego with boating, canoeing, and fishing, vying with each other for your pleasure, and the tennis courts and the polo fields. They were marketeers. As well as a swim park on the lake for country club members. The original Lake Oswego Golf, Oswego Lake Golf Course was featured on the cover of the classic work of golf architecture. As an aside, the copies of the first edition go for over $1,300, and reprints can command $400. So if you see it at a garage sale, buy it. The terrain on the Iron Mountain part of the course was so steep that a Pierce Arrow touring car was rigged up on the tracks to transport golfers and their clubs to the 12th tee. In this photo, you can see the clubs in the front where the car's motor would have been. And here's an example of one of the Ladd Estate Company's many sales brochures. This one features the Country Club District, and it again uses the oft-repeated slogan, "Live where you play." Another brochure assured home buyers that, quote, Portland's growth cannot reach out in years to come and steal the privileges enjoyed by those living in this incomparable residential recreational community, unquote. In 1928, a new Forest Hills branch sales office was opened to accommodate the growing real estate business. This building is one of four or five Lat Estate Company branch offices in Oswego, and it still stands at A and Avenue and 10th Street. The directions say, come to Oswego and turn right on pavement 1 mile. And the reason it says that is because in 1927, the Lat Estate Company was actually instrumental in paving A Avenue to improve access to the Country Club District and their new sales office. Murphy continued to work out of his downtown Portland office, not the Forest Hills branch sales office. The colonial design of this building has been attributed to Charles W. Ertz, but our research has provided no real evidence to support this claim. 11 years after it was constructed, the building was altered extensively and remodeled into a residence by the architect C.W. Jackson. Richard Sundeleep designed the Lat Estate model house next door to the sales office. When it opened on July 10, 1937, the public witnessed such innovations as automatic garage door openers, rolling concealed window screens, an electric dishwasher, and a power-driven garbage disposal. The kitchen design, it was said, eliminated up to 75% of the steps usually required for the preparation of a meal. Modern convenience is packaged in architect design charm. This house exemplifies a vision for the entire district, and it's listed on the National Register of Historic Places. Across the street from the Lat Estate Company model house stands another model house built in 1936. Richard Sundeleep also designed it for the Lat Estate Company. And the house was built to showcase innovative products of the Johns Manville Company, such as asbestos. Yeah. Several model houses were built in Oswego. Two others are the Gas House and the Life House. These aren't as ominous as they might sound. The Gas Company and Life Magazine sponsored these homes. The first Oregon Iron Steel Company development was platted in 1912 and was named Lakeview Villas. The choice of the word villas was a deliberate attempt to lend a continental upscale flair to the project. That same year, Oregon Iron and Steel petitioned the U.S. Geographic Board to change the name of Sucker Lake to Oswego Lake, definitely a more marketable name. The pattern of selecting language or changing existing terminology was set. It's another example of how the town was transformed, using words to shape reality. As you can see, according to the sales brochure, Lakeview Villas are, quote, a strictly high-class residence district. Spring water is piped to the lots, electric lights and telephones are being installed as rapidly as possible, unquote. On another aside, in 1913, the name of the lake was officially changed to Oswego Lake, but the name of the town remained Oswego for another 47 years until 1960, when Lake was added to reflect the annexation of the entire lake. Thus, the lake's name is Oswego Lake, and the city's name is Lake Oswego. From the shores of Lakeview Park, which opened in 1913 and is now named the Lake Grove Swim Park, Atchison and Allen, the Oregon Iron and Steel Company's marketing agent, toured prospective buyers past lakeside lots in a jaunty excursion boat named the Lotus. The lack of good roads, dampness, and the still untamed nature of the shore conspired to make lakefront property less desirable than home sites with a lake view. Ward Cotton Smith recalled, quote, in order to buy an acre of land, they had to buy a lot on the lake for $50, unquote. Atchison and Allen had the helpful suggestion of using the lakefront lot as a watering hole for the family cow. In 1914, the red electric streetcar brought a new mobility to the population and facilitated development of previously remote areas such as Lake Grove. The cars carried potential home buyers as well as Portlanders on Sunday outings. By the 1920s, So many visitors paraded around town that Oswego city councilors actually banned bathing suits on public streets, and the town marshal gave boys tomatoes to throw at the scofflaws. Law enforcement has since changed tactics. Within 15 years, buses and automobiles replaced the rail service, and the last red electric ran in 1929. The Ladd Estate Company, headquartered in downtown Portland, opened their first branch sales office in Oswego at the entrance to Lakewood in 1925. An advertisement that same year declared, quote, "Of all Lake Oswego's district, Lakewood is the most accessible, the nearest, possessed of modern advantages. There is no more beautiful spot anywhere," unquote. And remember, a decade earlier, Ward Cotton Smith had come out to Oswego to look for the lake and found a mud hole down on State Street. During the industrial era, pipe cores for the pipe foundry and bricks for the second furnace were made from clay deposits in what locals called the duck pond. By 1928, the marshy area had been flooded by the Ladd Estate Company to create Lakewood Bay and beautify their development named Lakewood on the shores of the pond. A fine was proposed for anyone referring to Lakewood Bay by its former unglamorous name. Again, language was manipulated along with the landscape. One other iron industry site is located in Lakewood, a rock quarry that provided basalt for the construction of the first iron furnace became a lakeside rock garden, as you can see in this 1965 photo. Some of the stone for the first Morrison Street Bridge, built in 1887, was also quarried in Oswego. Makeshift tent cottages were for rent in Oswego and Lake Grove in the teens. This 1915 postcard says, quote, "This is Jim and Lucille's country house on Oswego Lake," unquote. Note the Victrola and the canvas tenting over the board siding. As the Ladd Estate Company developed the area, they used deed restrictions to prohibit rental properties and to enforce compliance with other use and building restrictions. Restrictions were useful prior to the adoption of municipal building codes, but they were unfortunately also used to discriminate against minorities. In 1935, Murphy, inspired by a trip to Italy, had the Ladd Estate Company build high-end rentals on Lakewood Bay modeled after Italian cabanas that might be found on Lake Como. Well-known local architect Richard Sundeley designed them in the international style. These structures, built on piers, featured gangplanks and other nautical details. Murphy had a generosity of spirit that is rarely seen these days. His outright gifts to the community included Lakeview Park on the west end of the lake. In 1927, Murphy deeded it to the school board, and it was renamed Lake Grove Swim Park. The Ladd Estate Company, under Paul C. Murphy's direction, donated land for the Oswego Municipal Swim Park on the east end of the lake. It was dedicated in 1926 with the mayor and Lassie, the assistant guard dog, in attendance. These were not acts of self-aggrandizement. They were done for the greater good of the community. In fact, there isn't anything in Lake Oswego, not even a street, named after Paul C. Murphy. The activities on the lake changed along with the town. In 1866, John Trollender's steam scows ferried wheat and passengers across the lake. A succession of canoes, real estate launches, and power boats pulling water skiers followed. Here's Lillian Bickner on the left, paddling on the lake in her bonnet in the 19th century, and Miss Oregon water skiing with her dog Yogi on the right in 1966. All of these progressions signaled a move from industry to leisure. This photo of the Lake Oswego Water Ski Club is one of my favorites. Murphy accomplished his vision and set the course for the future. The transition from pig iron to nine irons was complete. Paul C. Murphy's association with Oswego lasted for two decades prior to his retirement in the 1940s. Murphy's vision shaped the town, although he and his wife, May, never lived in the town he did so much to create. His son, Paul F. Murphy, shown here on the left, succeeded him, but the transition signaled the end of an era. Murphy had wanted the best, and he led by example. Architect designed homes equipped with the most modern conveniences were accompanied by world-class recreational amenities. Dynamite and shovels permanently changed the natural landscape, but the point was to improve upon nature, not to erase it. Natural materials such as stone, brick, and wood were selected to blend houses in with their settings. Lakeshore lots that were practically given away almost a century ago are now among the most expensive real estate in Oregon. Multi-million dollar mansions have taken the place of rustic summer cottages. Gone are the population fluctuations that spiked in summer months. Since 1880, the population has increased from 97 people to over 36,000. The city has grown from a single neighborhood to over 25. This almost 5,000 square foot house was built in 1927. Architecturally, it exemplified Murphy's vision for the district, a romantic country lodge designed in the English Tudor style. Architect Charles W. Ertz designed it as his own residence, and it was beautifully sited on the lake shore. In this photo, you can see Ertz sitting in his garden and gazing out at the lake. This house was demolished in 2000, despite the fact it was listed on the National Register of Historic Places. A 1963 New York Times editorial stated, quote, "We will probably not be judged by the monuments we build, but by those we destroy," unquote. As a built legacy that Paul C. Murphy so carefully crafted is being altered beyond recognition or demolished to make way for new construction, the allure of the town survives. Murphy's vision of creating a resort-like community of fine neighborhoods out of industrial land holdings, a neglected lake, and a marshy duck pond was an utterly transformative alchemy that turned iron into gold that still glitters to this day. A 1928 newspaper article sums it up, quote, "Nature, assisted by the Ladd Estate Company, has done its share," unquote. Thank you.